Hello, welcome to Creative Ideas at Home in the British Rowing Lockdown Webinar Series. This webinar series is brought to you in association with British Rowing's official analytics partner, SAS, working to help give you the power to row. This webinar will be delivered by British Rowing's Henley Royal Regatta Charitable Trust coaches. All of this evening's presenters are funded through the Henley Royal Regatta Charitable Trust Coaching Scholarship Programme. British Rowing greatly appreciates the support of the Charitable Trust in our work to provide rowing opportunities to young people who would otherwise not have the opportunity to take part in the sport of rowing. I'm Tim Messant, British Rowing Education and Training Manager and facilitator for this evening's session. I have the pleasure of introducing to you Amy McCarthy, based at City of Sunderland Rowing Club, Jess Harris, based at Dorney Lake Boat Club, and Ellie Sadler, based at Star Club, Bedford. All of the coaches work for British Rowing part-time and study a university master's degree part-time over a two-year period. Before we get started, please could I remind everyone that this evening's webinar will be recorded. If you have any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat box at the bottom right-hand side of your screen. We will endeavour to answer as many questions as we possibly can at the end of the presentation this evening. If we can't answer your question for whatever reason, we'll add a PDF to the British Rowing website along with the presentation, the questions and answers that we can't answer, and the recorded webinar. Before we get started, I'd just like to say a massive thank you to everybody who's joined this evening. The coaches, we hope to be able to give a couple of golden nuggets of information you're able to take back into your coaching practice or reaffirm some ideas that you're having during this lockdown period. For the athletes and rowers, we hope that we'll be able to give a bit of variety to your training. And for parents and carers, we're hoping we're able to give a little bit of advice on how you might motivate the young people during this really difficult time. Without further ado, I'd like to pass over to Amy, who will take you through the start of the presentation. Thank you. Thanks, Amy.
Hi there, I'm Amy, and the key objectives that we aim to achieve during this webinar are how to create games for training purposes, the use of household equipment as work and equipment, how to creatively maintain fitness in the wider club, how to creatively keep motivated during lockdown, and how to creatively sustain club community. So, here is a game to start thinking creatively. You will have 30 seconds on each slide to run and grab a household item that would replicate a piece of sporting equipment. Here's the challenge though, it cannot actually be anything sport related. For example, if I asked you to get something that replicates a tennis net, you could go and grab yourself a bed sheet. By the end of this challenge, you'll have a full set of non-sports related sporting equipment that you can use from home during isolation. Take a photo and tag us on at British Rowing's Twitter account with the hashtag stay home and hashtag be all get creative. Ready? So now you're going to find something you could use as a dumbbell in your house in 30 seconds. Off you go. Okay, next, you have 30 seconds to go and find something in your house that's going to replicate a kettlebell. Ready? Off you go. Good job. And last of all, you're going to go and find something that you could use as a plyometrics box within your household. Ready? Off you go. Excellent. Don't forget to tag us on Twitter with a photo of what you've come up with. I'm going to pass it over to Jess now to look at creating games for training.
Hi, I'm Jess. So the first section I'm going to go through is creating games for training. It's very easy, I think, in rowing in particular, to just think about mileage. So I think now is the time we need to take a step back, and vary our training from the traditional rowing training. So we use games day in and day out for our schools programme, and although we focus on learn to row, the principles can definitely be taken to performance athletes. And just to have a, I'm going to do X sets of 1500. So to break it down when you're designing the game, I've split it into four. So firstly, we have what is your goal? How are you going to achieve it? What is going to motivate your athletes? And what equipment is required? So just to reiterate that point, what is the outcome of the goal? And what is the purpose? What format is it going to take and how will it be structured? What is going to be engaging and how are you going to maintain buy-in? And lastly, what resources and equipment is necessary? So I'm going to go through each stage, talk about a game for each. But the main thing is for you to start thinking about what equipment you have, what is appropriate for your squad, or even if it's for yourself or your family or the wider club. Something about your goals. Firstly, you've got to decide, is it a process goal or performance? So process refers to the smaller steps. So it could be ergo test preparation, or you've been given target splits, whereas performance would be the actual test itself. With this in mind, obviously not everyone is going to have access to a rowing machine. So we need to start thinking about what sort of training is able to be done at home. So strength and power is a little bit more difficult because not everyone's going to have access to a gym or anything that they could squat, for example. But that doesn't mean you can't train power in different ways. So there's things you could use for plyometrics, focus on eccentric exercises, so you've got a lighter weight, and single work as well. And all of these things will then in turn actually help with the athleticism pillar of the rower development guide as well. Agility is something that rowers definitely do not do. Obviously, we all say rowers don't run. But now is the time to sort of make use of that. And especially if you have a garden, it's really easy to do speed and agility training. And again, those single leg exercises and doing things with cones, things that perhaps footballers or rugby players would do. Now's the time to really try and develop those muscles that will then help you become a well-rounded athlete. Fitness and endurance. Again, people are running a lot. People have got turbo trainers. If you've got a rowing machine, great. But I wouldn't treat this as winter, okay? It's not an extended winter period. You don't want to be doing 3-6Ks all the time because this might happen until spring next year. So imagine if you've done it, well, it'll be a year and a half of winter training. That's not really very fun, is it? And you could also incorporate education and skills into this. Younger juniors in particular, you might want to have games that teach them about the history of your club or the national curriculum as well. So really easy to tie in PE and biology or other sports as well. And lastly, the most important thing is to have fun. So most people are going to be pretty bored, especially kids at this time. And it's actually quite scary. We don't know what's going to happen. And some people might not actually like socializing with people in their houses. So it's a great time to, although we're being physically distant, we must be mentally inspiring and social at the same time. So the first game looks at football formations, okay? It's not the traditional rowing game, and it focuses on four regions. It's essentially a circuit, but it's trying to put the same green. There are the little t-shirts with where the name would be, but the exercise and the number, which would be the number of reps. So you'd go through your defense, which is, well, the formation we've got here is 4-4-2. So you would do a set of the defense. So you do the exercises there four times, move on to midfield, that'd be four times, and the forwards you would do twice. And this can, you can do it on your own, or you can make it a group activity. Maybe if you're doing it as a family, one person is a defender, one person's midfield, and another is a forward, and time how long it takes for them. And then you can decide who is the most efficient in each formation. Moving on to our next section is achieving. So how is your session going to be structured? What sort of format is it going to take? So obviously there is a football match. So there's obviously so many sports you can games and party games, as well as video games. Is it going to be a challenge? So a lot of clubs are doing how far around the world you can travel. This could again be something that you could incorporate with where you're supposed to be on your Easter training camp, for example. Can you get there and back in a certain amount of days? Just something like that to make it still relevant to your own situation as well. And it's really important if it's going to be team or individual, and to consider that people at home might be training on their own, but it's nice to have an option whether they can or not, because not all parents will want to get involved as well. So here's some little examples and pictures to go along with that. Obviously we've talked about football already, and we're going to come on to a video game a little bit later on. And one of my favorites is Monopoly. Everyone has access, well, not everyone, a lot of people have a Monopoly boards in it, or Jenga or cards. So use those and really try and bring some more traditional games into your training. Oh, I've gone too far. Okay. Sorry, I've got a bit of a lag, but the game I was going to talk about, oh, thank you, is Snakes and Ladders. So don't be alarmed at how many kids actually have never played Snakes and Ladders. We use this one quite a lot, and there are quite a few people that have never seen it, along with who don't actually know how to tell the time as well, because everything's always on a screen. So this is a great opportunity to use an older game, and you play it just as you normally would Snakes and Ladders. Assign a number of meters per square. So say I roll a three and I've chosen 50 meters per square, you would row 150 meters. And then here I would land on a ladder and then move on up. If you land on a ladder or a snake, you can half the amount of reps or decide. If you're doing it in teams as well, you can choose forfeits for the other teams, just something to get everyone involved with. Okay, how are you going to motivate your audience? And what is going to make them buy in and actually want to carry on with your session? So it could be there are points awarded for the tasks that they're doing, and you have a leaderboard. And this could be over, well, a week or months or the whole time. If it's a technique-based and process-based task, how will this feedback be offered? It might not be possible, but you could use video footage and use online media as well. If you are going to do that, please make sure you keep up to date with safeguarding advice and guidance. As I mentioned there, is it going to be short term or long term? You could have a target changes every week, depending on their performance the week before. And lastly, what language is going to be used, and make sure it's appropriate. So The games we've used here are, as I mentioned before, Target and Learn to Row, and they're quite young, but you can change those tasks to treat a older audience. And if you're catering for a large group, consider the different learning styles. And that could be that you have a number of sessions available with the same principles. They're just set out differently. Or people could choose which one they want to do. Some people might want to do snakes and ladders. Some people might not be interested and just want to do sprints. So here I've got a Noah's Ark game. And this one focuses on long-term progressive targets on the erg. But it could also be done with squats, for example, and I'll come on to the watts in a bit later, but you could have just a number of squats. So the arc is 2,000 meters away from the shore, and you want to row your pair of animals, your 2x2 mice, to the arc. And the watts required increases the bigger the animal is, okay? And this could be individualized, so you could still compare across a group of people. If you were to choose a standardized calculation to decide the amount of watts required for each animal. So it could be that the mouse was 50% of their 2K PB, for example. So that's just one idea of how to make quite a horrible session, which could end up being 7 2Ks, a little bit more exciting. Also, I think changing it to wattage as well, rather than splits, everyone gets sort of stuck on, oh, I need this target split. Just changing that up gives it a little bit variation, and so you're not targeting the same thing every time. And the last part of our design is the equipment. So how is the session going to be delivered and what resources are required? Obviously, we're so lucky that we've got social media in this time. So it could be that you're going to post it online and then everyone has access to it and does it in their own time. Are you going to use a conference app such as Zoom and have everyone together? Again, think about the safeguarding if it is with children. And does the actual session involve an erg, or is there any other equipment? And Ellie's going to talk about equipment later on. A top tip here would be, if you do have a machine, make the most of it. So don't just do rowing on it. You can use it for, say, bicep curls or rollouts as well, for example. And it's important to consider whether it can be done inside or outside. So everyone has varied homes at the moment where they're isolating, especially people in the city where they might not have access to a garden at all. So again, it might be you need to write a few sessions for people to pick and choose. And are your sessions going to be tracked, and do you need feedback for them? So people would use Google Sheets, for example, some way that you can track everyone's training. But it might be that you just don't need any data. I think everyone gets stuck on data as well. And really, this is a time where you don't need data. We have so much data on the news. Maybe just have a bit of fun as well. So the last game is Candy Crush. It's a well-known online app. I think it's maybe a Facebook game, where you're going to move and match up the candies. And this I've left quite broad, but essentially, again, this is a circuit where you can let the athletes take ownership of their own session. So you could have where each candy represents either a piece of equipment. So if they, you would start on the top left and move along and just run it along as a circuit, similar to snakes and ladders, but without dice. But you could have it where each colour is a piece of equipment. So if you land on a green, you have to do something with a chair. Or it could be everything is a squat, but then it's a different equipment with the squat. Or each colour just represents a different activity altogether. And then if they're adjacent, you decide what you want to do, whether you want to triple the reps, double the reps when you land on each candy. So again, I think it's really important to let your athletes have some ownership over their own training. So overall, we've covered all aspects of the game. So goals, how to achieve it, how to motivate, and what equipment. So think back to the equipment you found at the beginning, and if any of those will fit into what we've discussed, or if you've got any ideas, things that you already use. And take a picture of what you've got, if you've got some games already lined up in your head, and tag us on Twitter and yeah, let us know what you've come up with. I think now is a really important time to actually share. I think coaches don't share enough, but really no idea is ever your own. You're always stealing from other people. So we need to develop our toolkits in this time. So I'm going to move on and pass over to Ellie now.
Hi, I'm Ellie. So I'm going to be talking about creating circuits and equipment. So to start with, it's always good to think about what your realistic goals are during this lockdown. Now is the time to see how you can still keep fit and health active whilst using your imagination. So it could be that your goal is just to stay as active as you can. It could be that you want to maintain your fitness you've built up pre-lockdown, or you want to use this time to really focus on your weaknesses. And I'll go into this in a little bit more detail a bit later. So for a lot of people, it might be that lack of equipment is making staying fit and active during lockdown quite difficult. So here I have a series of photos of me using different household equipment to complete strength training. So firstly, I got a backpack and filled it with all of the heavy books that I own. And this worked really well for these two exercises. So here I'm doing lunges with a backpack on, and I'm just doing laps of my garden. And also I did bent over row using a chair as a bench. So here I'm using books again to create an incline and a decline for press ups. And this is really great to vary your range of movement. So in the second two, I've placed them under my feet to create a decline. And this is really good as it makes the press ups harder, as it encourages you to use more of your body weight. So similarly for the first two, I've placed two stacks of books underneath my hands for an incline press up. And this really helps for your range of movement. So as you can see in these exercise variations, I'm using milk bottles. So the first two, I've got a milk bottle in each hand for a split squat and a step up, which are really great for isolating the glutes. And for the second variation here, I'm using a step ladder instead of a chair. For the squat and the overhead press, which are two really great compound movements, I've made a barbell from a broom hooking milk bottles on either end. So you do have the option to make this harder by adding another milk bottle or potentially hooking bags on the end and filling them with all the heavy objects that you have, as long as they're even. So the last couple of household items I've used are shown here. So this is me using a plant pot to do a deadlift and a 2-litre bottle of water to do a glute bridge. A towel is a really great alternative if you don't own a resistant band. It's great for mobility work. So this is all the household equipment I found to complete as many weighted exercises as possible. Please do tag us on Twitter using the hashtag #VRGetCreative and show us what you've thought of. The details will be shown at the end. So the next thing I want to discuss with you are different circuit variations that you can use to keep your training interesting at home. So the four I want to talk about are HIIT training, Tabata training, EMOM and AMRAP. So the first circuit variation is high intensity interval training, so HIIT training. HIIT training involves short bursts of intense exercise followed by equal or longer periods of rest. So HIIT training, quite similarly to the other circuits I'm going to mention, don't usually last longer than 30 minutes. They usually range from about 20 to 30 minutes. So my example for HIIT training is 10 lots of 1-minute sprints with 1-minute jog in between. This can be varied. You can do 10 lots of 500 meter sprints with 1-minute jog. They really are open to variation. So the next circuit variation, I want to talk about is Tabata training. So Tabata training is based on the equation 20, 10 times 8 equals 4. So this breaks down to 20 minutes exercise followed by 10 seconds rest. And this is repeated 8 times to leave 4 minutes of work. So the example I've put here are 5 exercises of burpees, jump lunges, air squats, mountain climbers and scissor kicks. They're all bodyweight exercises. So you do 20 seconds of burpees followed by 10 seconds rest, repeated 8 times for 4 minutes of work. Between each circuit, you would do 1-minute rest, and this will leave a 20-minute Tabata workout. So the next circuit is EMOM, which stands for every minute on the minute. So in an EMOM workout, you'll perform a specific exercise at the start of every minute for a specific amount of time. So in this example, I've said that you can set your timer for 7 minutes, and at the start of every minute, you do the exercise followed with the written amount of reps. So for example, on the first minute, you do 12 press-ups, and then you'd rest for the remainder of the minute. And on the second minute, you do 15 burpees and rest for the remainder of the minute. And I put here that you can rest for 3 minutes between sets and repeat 3 times. But again, this is really open to variation. You can switch it up as much as you like. So the last one I want to talk about is AMRAP. This stands for as many reps as possible. So the aim of an AMRAP workout is to complete as many rounds or as many reps as possible in a certain amount of time. So the example here, I've done 6 exercises with 10 reps. And what you do is you set a timer for say 15 minutes and see how many times you can get through this circuit. And this is a really great one to send out to the rest of your squad or the rest of your club and have some friendly competition with it. Or you can just keep a record and set yourself a goal. So the last, So the last circuit variation I want to discuss is the cards game. So this can be adapted by changing the exercises or changing the reps to make it harder or easier. So for this variation, each suit represents an exercise and each number and Jack, Queen and King represents the number of reps. So for example, if you picked the Queen of Hearts, you'd do 12 jumping jacks. So for this particular version, I've said the ace is 10 burpees and the joker is all of the exercises for 10 reps, including the burpees. So the aim is to get through all 52 or 54 cards as quickly as possible. Again, this is really open to variation. You can change the exercises or you can change the number of reps and you can switch up as much as you like. So the next part I want to draw your attention to is the goal of focusing on your weaknesses. So I want you all to think about your training pre-lockdown and how much should you focus on mobility and stretching as part of your everyday training. It may not have been as much as you could have. So now with having more time, I think it's a really great opportunity to focus on these components in order to build on your athleticism. So in the Road Development Guide, which I've attached to the bottom of this slide, there are 3 main areas of athleticism which can all be worked on from home. So these are core stability, flexibility and movement patterns. So all these areas are really important to become a great athlete, and this time could be used wisely to work on this. So following on from this, the last exercise game I want to discuss is called letter mobility. So here are 26 mobility exercises with a certain amount of repetitions. So how this works is you can choose a word, phrase or sentence and complete the exercises that are associated with this. So for example, star rowing club, you do 10 scorpion on your front, 10 child's pose to upward dog, 10 side lunges and 10 wide press ups. You could then have a 10 second rest and then you could do 10 wide press ups, 12 walkouts and so on and so forth. So the last thing I want to talk about is how you can use these circuits to maintain club community. So 2 of the circuits I've mentioned, such as AMRAP and the cards game, are really great variations that you can send out to other members of your squad to create friendly competition. So for example, the AMRAP version can be used by sending in how many times you completed the circuit in a certain allotted amount of time. And the cards game can be used by sending in how long it took you to complete all 54 cards. Another option as a way to sustain club community would be to send out weekly competitions such as how many burpees can you do in 90 seconds or how long can you hold a plank for, and you can create a leaderboard and send that out weekly. So I will now pass you over to Amy, who's going to talk about motivation.
Thanks, Ellie. So in terms of motivation and keeping with the theme of creativity, this content is going to cover various motivational styles for both a training and working environment, including how to adapt your home space for optimal working conditions. So, by not heading down to the rowing club, having minimal equipment, or only having 1 hour a day to go out and exercise, it can be difficult to motivate yourself to exercise at home. However, Staying fit and healthy with a good work and routine can optimise your performance in schoolwork, university work, or any other work and environment. Here are a few ideas of how to change up your routine and maintain a positive relationship with training. Firstly, FaceTime or webcam with a friend. Exercising together is a perfect way to uphold social distancing measures, as well as catch up with any teammates and motivate each other electronically face to face. Alternatively, if you're a member of a squad or a coach of a team, organise an online hangout with all team members and run a circuit session from home. Remember, if they're under 18, they must have parental permission and a legal guardian present. It is important to stay in touch with one another, and it can be made fun and challenging under the right context. Different hangout programmes include Zoom, Microsoft Teams, and Google Hangouts. Keep a training diary. Using a physical diary or apps like MyFitnessPal or Strava to keep documentation of any exercise can be massively motivational when reflecting on practice and identifying areas of improvement. This creates a meaningful document that assists in goal-setting processes, which you have time to manage and improve on whilst at home. Here's a training idea. Make a list of three things you would like to improve on by the end of lockdown, such as execute a single leg squat or engage in mental rehearsal preparations before a race. Then identify the small steps and stories of how you're going to achieve this so you can reflect on it by the end of lockdown. Keeping a diary also creates a log. If it's an online Google document or an online Google sheet, others can have access to it, such as coaches, so training can be monitored with feedback. Video analysis. Record videos of yourself undergoing basic movement patterns such as squatting or basic rowing sequencing patterns. For feedback, send the videos to your coach or play it alongside a YouTube video of an athlete doing the same exercises to see how the videos have similarities and differences. Alternatively, freeze frame the video and draw arrows of what the ideal body position is supposed to look like over the top of your photo. Training posters. By having a training poster that is large and has a plan on it, it can be a strong visual motivational tool and something you cannot ignore. Get creative, decorate and colour it, make it large enough to catch your eye, make smaller ones around the house to do different exercises at different places in the house. For example, when you're boiling the kettle, do a calf raise. Posters can be made on a daily basis, a week-to-week plan, or even a large calendar monthly plan with exercise programmes on it. So different ways to motivate from the desk. For coaches, students and general workers, motivation to write an essay or do your homework or engage in daily conference calls is likely to decrease, which is to be expected working from home. It is important to know that many people will be in the same position, and varying up the day with different content and creative thinking processes can increase productivity for the day. Set up your weekly calendar. It'll help you spread the workload across the week and to match it with exercise plans. Either buy a calendar or use online versions like Google Calendar that is adaptable and shareable with others, so you won't have social distractions and your friends can know when you're busy. It will also give you a notification for when you're due to change what you're doing, preventing working late or prioritising workload. Things to do today, planners. They cost around £2 from the likes of B&M or Family Bargains, and they include a day and a date, a priority tick box and a completed tick box. Get creative, use different pages for different jobs, use colours for different things to do, such as blue for rowing related work, green for schoolwork, or orange for housework. I've also attached a little URL on there so you can, it's an online one that you can tick off yourself. Inspirational methods. Write your favourite quotes on the individual pieces of paper and put them in a jar. Pull one out each day and focus your day around that one quote. Alternatively, upload a playlist on Apple Music or Spotify of songs that motivate you, or relaxing songs to keep you calm whilst working from home. Make a separate playlist for your exercise, as it's a great way to change the mood of a room so your brain knows what it's expected to do at this time. And also hourly exercises. Exercises on the hour, every hour, that help maintain posture and mobility during long periods of sitting down, such as ankle circles, tricep dips, squats and lunges. If you're not going to be a nuisance to anyone else in your household, set a timer to play a song every hour and get up and have a dance to that one song for the 3 or 4 minutes that it plays, similar to what a Fitbit would do when they beep to remind you to walk 250 steps that hour. How to achieve optimal working conditions from home. Work in a room that gets lots of natural light, so your eyesight isn't strained. Subconsciously, seeing sunlight will also automatically lift your mood. Setting up work near a window maintains the natural light and allows the fresh air to enter the room. Feeling stuffy can make you feel tired quicker. I personally like to take my work and sit outside when possible, so I feel like during lockdown I've actually left the house. Make sure you are working away from the bedroom, or at least away from your bed. People get into the habit of working on the sofa or in bed, which not only affects your posture, but affects your productivity. The bedroom should be associated with sleeping, and keeping work separate from that prevents functional complications with the brain affiliating the bedroom with sleep. Try to make sure there's optimal space for movement around the room. Stretching out and exercising when necessary, especially if you take up the dance every hour challenge. Getting dressed in work clothing, or at least out of loungewear, helps maintain routines. Keep the separation of breakfast and getting dressed from doing work and conference calls as well. Lots of people I know first thing are sat on calls with a bowl of crunchy nut cornflakes and a cuppa. Would you do this if you're at work or if you're at school? Also, don't get half ready. Make sure your bottom half matches your top half. Stay organised and stay tidy, as it increases productivity, as everything is at hand and you don't need to search for it. Think about implementing a filing system for different subjects, modules or workloads. Whiteboards are also really useful, as a sense of accomplishment wiping it off the board at the end of the day. Ensure your desk and your chairs are set correctly to maintain good posture and prevent pelvis rolling habits, as these will be harder to adapt and break when returning back to a board. Elbows are in a straight line and eyes are facing forward at the computer screen. Also, by sticking to work in hours and then exercising hours, it helps maintain a routine that is easier to implement back into everyday life after lockdown. This is where daily schedules come in handy. Even though it's easier, try not to work late past normal hours. It is great to see coaches taking it upon themselves to spread special words, photos and experiences, as this is a creative way to stay in communication with one another. Just recently, everyone was posting 5 meaningful words that reflected them. While some were moving and inspirational, there were also funny ones like "wine made me do it." It's amazing to see how many people's personalities and characteristics come out of coaching mode, and just remember that your job doesn't define you. Let's have a key takeaway point from this lockdown to keep showcasing the amazing work that we do in schools, communities and clubs. Be proud of what you've achieved and stay true to yourself. Don't forget to take a photo of your game designs and non-sports equipment and tag us on Twitter, or even to just stay in touch with the @BritishRowing with the hashtags #BeOurGetCreative, #StayInWorkOut, #StayHome. Or here's our personal accounts if you also would like to stay in touch. As a team, we reached out to the Twitter coaching community to share with us photos of your coaching. We took it upon ourselves to take your photos and make something special with it in this video, so thank you to those who contributed.
what you wanna be. So don't be someone else when you be the best so easily. If you try, if you need, my baby, you'll succeed.
So I'm sure everybody will agree that that was a really motivating finish, and let's just think about what we've got to look forward to when we come out of our current experience. And one of the things I absolutely take away from this evening is the sharing, and as coaches, having the opportunity to share during this lockdown period. And I guess remembering the friends that we've got out there within the coaching community, which is so important at this time. So we've got a few questions that have come in during the webinar. So Ellie, Jess and Amy, if you're able to, just make sure you're there and unmute yourselves, that'd be brilliant. And there's a really good opportunity now while we're just taking a couple of questions. If anybody else has got any questions, please feel free to add them into the chat box that's on the right-hand side of your screen. So one of the questions that's come through is around a coach talking about their career and how sometimes they felt quite isolated. And of course, we're now in a situation of isolation. And sometimes in your roles, there's no doubt that you are not all together as a group, you are working remotely. So we do check in through a virtual means on a relatively regular basis. Have you got any tips, top tips for working in isolation?
I think one of the great things for me was developing my Twitter account. I think that's been really great. I've been tagged in so many things, like Amy mentioned previously, about 5 words that really motivate you, and the coach's photos. I think that was a really great way to stay in touch with other coaches. So for me, that's something that really helped, definitely developing my Twitter account.
Thanks, Ellie. Jess, Amy, any other thoughts?
I would agree, just make sure you're staying in touch with other coaches, but also don't just talk to them about rowing as well. Like, make sure you have a conversation about how they're feeling, not just about, oh, I've got this session.
I agree with Ellie. I picked one main source of social media that I had, and that I wanted to make that more rowing focused, so I decided to go with Twitter. So I kept my other social media accounts separate for me and my friends, my family, and then my Twitter is where I've also got friends and family on, but also the wider rowing community. And it was a really good way to get in touch with everyone, stay in touch and share ideas. I feel like the more I give out, the more people would want to give back to me too. And it's all about just starting to feel open to everyone else.
And do you feel, Amy, that sort of like two-way communication is about sort of role modeling that behaviour a little bit for you as a coach, and does that rub off onto your athletes as well?
Absolutely, yeah. I think as well, being a coach, is if you're opening up that platform, your social media platform, for others to be able to see it, it is, you need to be able to stay in your professional role, but also be in a way that you can feel like you can be yourself. And likewise, when I then go back to being with athletes, with rowers, with anyone else who's wanting to take up the sport, I want to be myself too. And that also means anyone around me will get that same kind of feeling. So if I'm open and honest from the start, I get the same kind of feedback and response.
Brilliant, thank you. And we've had a question around gating the risk of using some of the equipment that you're using and you demonstrated tonight. So Ellie, I guess, what did you do to make sure that the equipment was safe that you were using?
I always made sure that the equipment was kind of in my lifting range. I always, so like the plant pot, for example, it was a bit risky about whether or not I would be able to lift it. So you always just make sure that they are in your lifting range. I also think technique is a big factor as well. Always make sure that you can do the exercises without a weight, and then before you do it with a weight. And also with things like the milk bottles, there is always the risk of perhaps maybe one sliding off the end. So just make sure that it's never too heavy. And I think that probably would solve a lot of the problems. Yeah.
Perfect. Great. And if we get in any other questions that come in, we will make sure that everybody gets access to those through the website. We'll also make sure that the slides are available online in a PDF form, so people can refer back to some of the brilliant games that you have put together. And I think the big thing as well to take away from this evening is there's that opportunity to really play with those games and make them work for the environment that you're operating in and your athletes are operating in, whether that be as a team or whether that be as individuals. There's loads of scope there, isn't there? Jess, just give us a little bit of a variation on your snakes and ladders game. So it talks about rowing in the snakes and ladders game. What would you do in the place of rowing?
So a simple one off the top of my head would be, if you roll an odd number, do that amount of squats, and if it's an even number, maybe not burpees, maybe press ups, and then you've got arms and legs going on.
Great, thanks very much. That concludes this evening's webinar. There's just one thing that I'd like to say is a huge thank you, as we said earlier, to everybody for taking the time out this evening to come and hopefully get a couple of golden nuggets of information that they can take back into their coaching environments. And we've been through some questions, and we'll make sure that they're on the British Rowing website with any answers, if there's any more that come in the next little while. And we'd also like to say thank you to British Rowing's official analytics partner, SAS, for their support in the lockdown webinars. We finish a little bit early, so there's the opportunity to be able to get out and make sure that we all hugely thank the NHS and the social care teams that are keeping people so safe. And just from me, thank you very much. Have a great evening and good night.